This is Vijay from Dynatech in India. In this video, the procedure for getting a good strain gauge installation on glass beam is shown. The first step in strain gauge installation is degreasing. This is achieved by spraying CSM-3 degreaser on a gauze sponge and wiping the surface of the beam thoroughly to remove all traces of oily and greasy substances that are detrimental to gauge bonding. Next, the surface is abraded with a 600 grit abrasive paper to get a matte surface on the glass. A few drops of imprep conditioner on the surface helps considerably as it is acidic and detects the contaminants and removes them. Scrubbing is done with a cotton tipped applicator. Then a folded gauze pad is used to wipe away the liquid from the surface. One wipe in each direction starting from the middle. Wiping the surface in a back and forth movement will spread the dirt but not remove it, so wiping back and forth should be avoided. Final cleaning is done with neutralizer, an alkaline liquid that neutralizes the acidity on the surface caused by the conditioner. If the neutralizer tends to dry on the surface, more neutralizer should be used while scrubbing. Wiping away the neutralizer with a folded gauze pad, one wipe in each direction from the middle, will render the surface clean and ready for bonding a strain gauge. A glass plate is used as a working surface for handling strain gauges. The glass plate is cleaned with a few drops of neutralizer to ensure that it is free of dirt or dust. To handle a strain gauge safely, a blunt tipped tweezers such as the BTW-1 is used. To remove the gauge from its packing and lay it on the glass plate which is cleaned with neutralizer, making sure that the top side of the gauge is facing up. To transfer the gauge to the beam, a special tape such as the PCT 2M tape is used, as it does not leave its sticky mastic behind on surfaces. A length of 3 to 4 inches of PCT 2M tape is laid over the gauge, and its edge is folded to make a handle to lift the tape again. The tape is lifted from the glass plate at a shallow angle to minimize the bending of the gauge. It is positioned on the surface of the part, then one end is pressed down on the surface and the rest of the tape is pushed down gently. The gauge is inspected for correctness of the location. Then the tape is partially lifted off the surface at a shallow angle until the gauge is free. The tape is folded backwards to expose the bottom surface of the gauge. Next, a very small amount of M-bond 200 catalyst is applied to the bottom of the gauge. The brush is swiped against the bottle top several times to remove almost all of the catalyst. Then the bottom of the gauge is brushed just once. All the solvent in the catalyst should evaporate, which normally takes about a minute. Then the tape holding the gauge is held at an obtuse angle to the surface of the part. A drop of M-bond 200 adhesive is placed at the join of the tape and the part's surface. The tape is then held over the surface at a shallow angle and pressed down with a smooth sliding action using a folded gauze pad pushing out all excess adhesive all the way to the end of the tape. Thumb pressure is applied over the gage for at least 1 minute. About 2 minutes is allowed for the adhesive to set firmly. Then the tape is removed by peeling it back on itself along the surface. The gage is examined visually for any apparent defects such as unevenness or bulging or inadequate spread of the adhesive or air bubbles under the gage. The next step is to attach lead wires to the strain gauge. The gauge is covered with a piece of PDT-2 tape except for the tabs to protect the sensitive grid of the gauge during soldering. For single element strain gauges, a 3 lead wire connection is used to connect the gauge to an instrument as a quarter bridge. The conductors of one lead wire are separated from the other two, and the conductors are twisted tightly until the twist extends all the way to the insulation. The conductors are then tinned with 361A-20R solder, which has a lower melting point than most other solders. Fresh solder is applied to the tip of the soldering pencil to make a pool. The edge of the conductor is placed in the pool of solder, then fresh solder is fed into the pool as the lead wire is drawn away. This process is repeated for the other bundle of conductors. To have some flexibility between the conductors, they are separated at the insulation with a sharp knife. The conductors are then trimmed with a pair of diagonal cutters to have just over a millimeter of exposed wire beyond the insulation. The tabs of the strain gauge are also tinned with solder. The end of the solder wire is placed over the gauge tab, then touched with the tip of the soldering pencil, and a small amount of solder is fed into the tab before lifting the pencil away. The lead wires are positioned over the gauge tabs and held in place with a short length of PDT-2 tape. The lead wire is then heated with the tip of the soldering pencil, and a little fresh solder is fed into the joint before lifting the pencil away. This is repeated for the second lead wire. The solder joints are inspected for proper connection, and if necessary, they can be retouched with fresh solder. The PDT-2 tapes over the gauge and the wires are removed with a generous application of M-line rosin solvent, brushing the area a few times to dislodge the tape, which can be easily lifted away. The tapes should not be removed with any force to avoid damaging the soldered connections or the gauge. The strain gauge and solder joints are washed with M-line rosin solvent to remove all traces of flux residue and blotted dry with a gauze pad. Cleaning with rosin solvent is repeated a couple of times to ensure complete removal of flux from the area. In all strain gauge installations, it is very desirable to have some flexibility in the lead wires to minimize the possibility of breaking of the shoulder joints due to differential movement between the beam and the wire during testing. This is done by clamping the lead wire near the shoulder joints, then pressing a small round object under the wire and pressing the wire down on the other side to create a strain relief loop in the wire. The lead wires are then anchored to the test part with FA-2 aluminium foil tape, which has a strong adhesive backing. The strain gauge and lead wire joints are covered with a layer of M-coat A protective coating, which is applied with a brush. The coating dries in about 10 minutes and the gauge is ready for testing. The gauge is connected to a Model P3 strain indicator and the beam is loaded to see if gauge installation is satisfactory. An unchanging zero after balancing the reading. Stable and repeatable readings of strain under load, and a good return to zero when unloaded indicates reliable strain gauge installation. The extremely smooth surface of glass makes bonding of gauges to it a challenging exercise. The slight abrasion with 600 grit paper seems to have helped achieve a good bond.